Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Slow Art Friday. Today is May 29th. My name is Christy McMillan. I'm the Director of Learning and Engagement here at the Asheville Art Museum. And I am joined by Michelle Dorf, who's one of our wonderful touring docents. She's going to be leading today's conversation. Each Friday at 12 p.m. while the museum is closed, docents lead virtual, interactive conversations about a few artworks in our collection or special exhibitions. The goal is simple: slow down, discover the joy of looking at art, and talk about the experience with others. For today's program, Michelle will lead us in an interactive conversation about three artworks in our collection. We'll spend about 15 minutes or so with each artwork. Michelle will allow us time to look at each one on our own, slowly, before leading a conversation about each one with questions. As participants, we encourage you to engage in dialogue with Michelle, myself, and each other throughout the hour. A few notes before we get started. You noticed as you were getting logged in that your microphones and video are muted by default. If you'd like to start your video, you're more than welcome to do so at any time. Choose a quiet room and close the door. Silence alerts from devices. Since this is a program where we will be allowing you to unmute your microphone, if you have your microphone unmuted and things are dinging and blinging in the background, it can be pretty distracting. Try not to sit in front of a window, lamp, or other strong light source if you choose to have your video on. It just makes it pretty hard for us to see you. Use headphones and a microphone for best sound quality. You might have noticed that I sound a little clearer today. It's because I got a brand new microphone, because people always told me that it was hard to hear me. So hopefully you can hear me better today. While you can log on using a smartphone, we do recommend using a desktop, laptop, or tablet so that you can see the slides and meeting tools on a larger screen. Make sure that your screen name includes your first name and last initial, or first name and last name, so that we know who we're talking to. In order to make questions or comments during the program, you can unmute your microphone when Michelle asks for questions or comments. You can also type into the chat box. The third way is to raise your hand in the participant sidebar. Michelle or I will call on you and unmute your microphone at that time. I can say just from experience with this group, people do like to jump in and chat and talk and ask questions. So sometimes it can be a little bit, people can wait for a while if you just raised your hand. So I do encourage you to just unmute your microphone and talk whenever you'd like. We are recording, so if you prefer not to be recorded, make sure that your video and audio remain muted and use the chat box to submit questions and comments. At this time, I am going to change the setting to allow folks to unmute yourselves as you would like to be able to contribute to the discussion. We do recommend please leaving off your sound and your microphone unless you're actively making a comment or asking a question so that we can maybe, as much as I like hearing the birds tweeting, sometimes, as I said, it can be a little bit distracting. So at this point, does anybody have any questions or comments before we get started? See a lot of familiar faces out there, as well as some new folks. Welcome to the new folks. Michelle, take it away. Michelle, are you there?
Ah, I had to unmute myself. There you go.
There you go.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Slow Art Friday. I see a lot of friends and familiar people who I've seen on Slow Art Fridays. And I have selected these artworks, and let's just have a lot of fun. Christy, the first slide, please. Okay, so let's take a few moments to look at this artwork. You might consider looking corner to corner and side to side as you're slowly looking at this. And in a moment, we'll come back and have a discussion. Okay. So let's take a look. What's going on in this artwork? What do you see?
Well, I think the colors make it very attractive. I think it almost looks like chalk in the medium that could have been used. And I also see various shapes with a number of what could be some sort of bottles or decanters, both standing straight, one on the left and headed towards the right, and a few maybe even bottles upside down.
Okay, great. So you're seeing could look like chalk. You're noticing the colors that are very pretty and colorful, and you're noticing that you're noticing bottles, and that could be either right side up or upside down. All right, someone else?
This is Patty. I'm noticing it looks like a tablescape to me because of what the last comment was. I see bottles, but it's very abstract. It's an abstract tablescape to me. So I can see things that look like food, decanters, a tablecloth, and then the colors are striking, and the use of red is interesting.
Awesome. Okay, striking colors. You're noticing that it's a still life, and you're liking the bright colors, and especially the red. Great. Anyone else?
It reminds me of an exercise we did in school. It was on cubism. And we started with a still life, and then we segmented it and went from light to dark in each segment. That right. That last step isn't done so much, but it reminds me, because you'd have fragments of the still life still appearing in the final piece. So it does remind me of that a little bit.
Yeah, so it's looking like a cubist work and something that reminds you of something you did in school. And I think a lot of people, when we did art class, did still lifes in many different forms. Anybody else?
Although there's a lot of colors, I noticed the use of the dark grays and blacks or charcoal to define the various objects, and that helps create the strikingness of the whole thing, yet where the colors stand out to you and they're pretty and attractive, but yet if you look closer, you can see all the dark. There's a lot of dark in there, but the picture doesn't look dark to me.
Right, yeah, so you're noticing that as much as it's colorful, that the gray and the black seem to actually outline things so that you can see them clearly, even though it appears as a very colorful picture.
Yes.
Great. Nice. Yeah, just to give you an idea, the size of this artwork is, I love these measurements, 13 3/8 by 20 5/8. Just to give you an idea.
What else? Funny, I had it in my mind that it was much larger than that. But I too saw the cubism, and yet I also see draping of fabric, maybe a tablecloth of some sort. So I find that interesting, that the simple cubic shapes that are there, that the artist has succeeded in making a draping
right.
as well.
Yeah, so you're noticing the cubism, but you're also noticing draping and shape. And let's take a look at that. So how does this look to you? We're seeing a table, we're seeing still life, but what about the gravity in this artwork?
Well, I was going to say, it looks to me like a traditional a Dutch still life, where things look as if they're falling off the table.
And do you see the table?
I do, but maybe because I think it's there. Uh-huh. But yeah, I think I do. I do. I do. And I think the drapery, the way what I see is fabric is draped over the side, like the lower left corner, the right down towards the bottom in the foreground. And then there looks to me to be a plate with some maybe food on it, all seems to be almost falling off the table. And that's
right.
what I traditionally think of when I think of a traditional still life, or so even a looking, Dutch still life. Let's say, put it
right. Down. Okay, so it's looking like a Dutch still life, traditional. You're seeing the draping, and it makes sense. And what's interesting is, as Laurel had pointed out before, is the use of the outline of the black that actually gives you the drape.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah,
very cool. Yeah.
This is Billy. There's a lot of movement because of what the artist has done with brushwork. The impact of the brushwork, creating movement, and actually, for me, leading my eye from left to right across the piece.
Yeah, a lot of movement in the brushwork, and has you moving, and it does. The piece does occur as moving. Yeah, it seems very liquid to me. Anybody else?
I almost see some letters in there towards the center left. It looks like a capital A and a C. I don't know if those mean anything or just happen to be there, but I see a letter A and I see a letter C.
Okay, so you're seeing letters in the artwork. And how does this artwork make you feel? What kind of mood does this put you in?
Rather subdued, I think, for me. Subdued, but inviting.
Okay. Kathy feels subdued and invited.
I would have to agree with the invited, yeah, as well.
Invited, ready to have a drink at the table, huh?
Yeah, even though it's crazy.
So I find it pleasant, pleasing, soothing to look at. But there's also a lot of activity and interest in it. And somehow my eye moves between the shapes that I see, but also the way the paint is so, is applicated. It's not in a thick way. It's in a very washy kind of way, which I think adds to this feeling that it's not heavy.
Right. Great. So it seems that it's light, not heavy, there's movement, the color, it's inviting, and it's pleasing. Great.
Mm-hmm. And it's almost in layers.
Yeah, it looks like it's in layers. And it looks, there's a lot of form and there's a lot of movement.
It feels festive to me.
And it feels festive. I agree. I think it looks very festive. I'm ready to sit at that table and have a drink.
Michelle, a couple people mentioned in the chat box that it reminds them of a puzzle. Mm.
I could see that. I'd actually like to do a jigsaw puzzle like this. Anybody else? Jigsaw puzzles are very popular these days.
The more I'm
curious about the object on the right, a white object outlined in black, could be a vase. Not too sure, but I really am quite attracted to that object, and no one has mentioned it.
Could it be a goblet, being that it's right near the wine or the bottle nearby?
Right, so you're noticing the shape that's near the bottle. Could be a goblet, could be a vase.
Could be a pitcher, too, because the handle on the right, most right, is looks like the handle, sort of a milk glass kind of either vase or pitcher.
What other shapes are you seeing in the
Some of it reminded me of napkins, the way they fold them in restaurants as well.
Okay, you're seeing napkins, yeah. And somebody else is going to say something?
I was just saying it has a look of a candelabra to it, perhaps.
And where are you seeing the candelabra look?
To the far right, that object that we're discussing, is it a pitcher? Because it does have that lip of a pitcher, but then it also has like three cylinders that could hold candles.
Ah, oh. I see that. So Christy, can you put the arrow on that area?
Which area, Michelle?
The white area, the goblet, base, candelabra that we're talking about. Yeah, right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see that as a candelabra.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. But it's interesting, it has that pointed edge, so I don't know. Yeah, it is an interesting shape, Mary. Thanks for bringing that up.
It looks like it could be broken because it has like jagged edges on the top.
Looks like it could be broken, jagged edges. Yeah, makes sense. So if you had this in your house, where would it be? What room?
Dining, I don't know.
I'd like it in my dining room myself.
Yeah. That's what I was thinking.
I agree.
I would like to have an enclosed porch area and have it hanging out there for where I would be entertaining.
Nice. I like it, Mary. I'm coming to your house.
First, we have to build that enclosed porch area.
Because of the size, it might work well also in a kitchen.
Right, because basically 14 by 21. Yeah, good.
And it's oil on masonite, so it would be durable enough to be installed in a kitchen.
Absolutely.
I think if it was complicated as a backsplash, it would look really nice in a kitchen.
Oh, yeah. That would. I like that idea. Any other ideas for decorating with this artwork?
I have an idea about the composition of the painting. I'm trying to imagine it without the black lines and seeing how, trying to figure out the interplay between the black line and the color. And, you know, if you could magically erase all the black lines, what would it look like? And how did the artist think about painting that? Did she just do all the color and then draw the lines over it? Or it would be interesting to think about the process of that.
You know, that is a really great observation. Something that I never even considered, but you know, it makes a lot of sense because as Billy was saying before, all the brush strokes in this artwork that create so much movement, you could actually almost see the artist creating the background or creating the artwork and then going in with the grays and the blacks. Very interesting. I like that.
I also had one other thought about somebody had commented on the sort of the curious perspective of the still life and how it looks a little slanted or artificial. And I'm wondering if it's an unconscious nod to Cézanne's still life with the pears that are, you look at the table and they would fall off the table if they were presented in real life. You know, and this has the same sort of weird perspective on it in terms of how the things are placed on the table.
Right. So you're saying that the perspective is similar to Cézanne and how if it were in real life that the items might actually fall off the table.
Yeah, and Cézanne's, you know, a lot of his still lifes look a lot more sort of real. You can identify the pears or the apples or whatever much more easily. It's not as abstract. On the other hand, you get some of the same kind of shifts in perspective there. So I just thought that was interesting.
Yeah, no, I think it's great. And
I comment about the black outline. I think the painting might have been created with a black outline and then painted over it. Because if you look at the background, you can see where the color, the surface color has been washed over an underlying outline of black, and then maybe added some more black added after the painting was in the process of being developed. So I think there was probably some, the black was used to create the shapes and some of the sizes and everything else, and then painted and then perhaps added more black delineation afterwards.
Right.
It's also very cubist in form, very flat. There's not a lot of they brought some shadows in with the color, but it appears to me quite flat, and I don't find it to be that flattering, but that's the style.
Great, thanks so much. And so what you notice is that it looked like it was outlined and then mm-hmm. all and painted and then outlined again. Mm-hmm. Got it. We have two other artworks that I'd like to get to, so I'm going to wrap this one up. Does anybody have any pressing last comments about this artwork?
This is Billy. I was just going to say that I see a lot of influence of Cezanne and that era in this work, in all three works, but I also see the cubism influence later, that came later. So it's a fun combination.
Yeah, mm-hmm. it's a great mm-hmm. combination. And mm-hmm. I've got people who are seeing French rolls on a plate and cheese. And
Mary made a great comment. She said it's after dinner and it's all the empties waiting for the cleaning up.
There you go. Getting hungry. Okay, so let's go to the next slide, Christy, just so that you can see. As Billy mentioned, this is oil on masonite, Richard Lloyd Andrews, one of our wonderful collection pieces from the Black Mountain College. And an interesting fact about this particular artist is he's one of the few artists or students of Black Mountain College who actually got a degree. Very interesting fact. Okay, so the next slide. Okay, here we go. Same thing, take a few moments to look at this artwork. All right. Who wants to begin with what they see that's going on in this artwork?
I see peaches and strawberries, and it looks like harvest season to me, and like late spring, early summer, a happy feeling, and the colors are quite striking.
Okay, beautiful.
It looks like a watercolor too, and some of that washiness on the left side with the white and gray shapes remind me of Georgia O'Keeffe's treatment of adobe walls.
Huh, okay, so beautiful bright colors, peaches, strawberries, harvest season, and a reminder of Georgia O'Keeffe on the left, that kind of billowy, cloudy feeling.
And therefore, contrast between the specificity of the fruit shapes and the baskets and that kind of background floaty, cloudy-like material.
Yeah, very interesting, the background floaty material and the suspended baskets of
berries,
maybe?
What? And I thought tomatoes. But I see everybody's suggestion there, and I'm glad we're at floaty cloudy, because it my first thought was, you know, it was snowy, which of course is ridiculedockle, as my mother would have said, with all this fresh produce. But fresh produce on top of the clouds is kind of ridiculedockle too, but I like it.
Yeah, that's what's interesting about this, is that particular thing, the clouds, the soft white. Yeah, but it works. It's great. Who else?
It's interesting. The one dark basket in the middle on the left, the big, is only partially full. So is it not yet been filled, or has it been emptied where someone took a taste and ate some of the peaches?
Yeah. Yeah, so you're noticing that the dark basket and that there's less fruit in there than the others.
It reminds
me of had the artist create the basket like that as opposed to all the others?
It's a way to draw your attention to the focal point of a painting. Maybe it shows the end of a season, coming to terms with the fall produce. I see the sun in the background, and it looks appears to be dissolving into the foreground. So I don't know. I was thinking maybe it's towards the end of the season. Things are coming to a close, perhaps. I don't know.
Okay, so you're thinking possibly toward the end of the season.
You're seeing that tilted table effect that is predominant in Dutch still lifes as well. And the time frame of this work is contemporary as compared with Dutch still lifes, but it has, and then it lends into that. I'm fascinated by this painting because it does have a very Georgia O'Keeffe look to it. The Art Institute of Chicago has many works of O'Keeffe's, and one of them called Clouds has that same sky effect.
Right.
Yeah, Billy, it's I like that painting too. It's called Sky Above Clouds, and this one you can call it like Strawberries Above Clouds.
Yeah, exactly. But I find it very interesting with all of this, that center placement of that darker basket.
Well, here's something curious too. There's the darker basket. It's the only one that has a handle. And that handle echoes the white, which shouldn't be white, but should be golden colored, of the the strap holding the basket together.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're noticing that the darker basket is the only one that has a handle.
And it almost, that strap almost looks like it's unfinished. It looks like the artist forgot to color that in.
Huh.
Yeah, right. I can see that.
And certainly the basket in the back is also dark. You only see a little bit of it, poking through left and the right without a handle. And it's quite full, but it does to me look like it's also a dark basket. And also I want to comment on the blue. The more I'm staring at the photo, because initially I was drawn to the oranges and reds, but there's on the bottom front to the right there is a bit of blue, dark blue with light where the defining of the table, and then the blue more by the strawberries or tomatoes.
Yeah, you're right. And then that upper right hand corner, just that peak of blue.
Barbara had noticed that the basket at the front is coming apart.
Or maybe it's unfinished like that other one. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The white in the handle and the white on the bottom basket looks like it's coming apart, or maybe it is unfinished because it's white.
I don't think the artist probably intended it to be unfinished. Most artists usually they can use that to carry your eye because it is white and it's so different. It carries your eye back, down and around and back up and around to the top. So I think they're using it as a visual cue.
Probably.
Right. And what about the perspective and the visual on this artwork? What do you think about the baskets that are in the Georgia O'Keeffe cloudy area in the back left?
Well, they're the small kind of green cardboard ones that hold berries. I mean, the front ones hold bigger produce, whether it's peaches or tomatoes. But what we're looking at in the back are, first of all, I'm moving my arrow as if you can all see it. There's a number of those cardboard ones, and then there's one plastic, same color. But in grocery stores,
right.
Those are the sorts of things that carry fruit, like
And what do you think those baskets are sitting on? What is that?
Clouds or snow.
Right.
That's what I find very interesting about this.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Could this be a metaphor of life, abundance and poverty, and especially the dark one? That's the one that only has a few pieces of fruit in it.
That's an interesting thought. Could be.
I thought it was hope.
This artist did have he had an interest in psychology and in the human condition. And so that it's very possible that that could be an interpretation and an inspiration.
Mm-hmm. I mean, even the basket that is overflowing is kind of busting out, it's breaking.
Right. Yeah, so you're noticing the full basket, and that's almost breaking the basket.
Yeah, it's kind of like maybe even the idea of greed. I mean, that one's the one that's the brightest and the spotlight is on it, but there's almost too much fruit in it that seems to be busting the basket out.
All right. And any other last comments? What do we see in this?
I was just curious, the corrugated baskets on the left, they seem unfinished along the top edges where they should have not been reflecting white but color. I wonder if that was left purposely left white, or was it to draw our attention to it, or do you see what I'm saying?
Yes. Which white?
Yeah.
In the baskets in the front or in the back?
The strawberry baskets. Along the top edges there, exactly. Why would they be white when they should be colored?
Were they right, left? You're seeing, Hetty, here, like it's a dark green
right
here.
Right,
on the inside.
Exactly, exactly. So did the artist leave it purposely to draw our attention to those areas, or was it just unfinished like the other areas?
Well, there's two different types of little green baskets, so maybe
right,
they are white inside. And I also love the use of white, too, as one of the previous commenters said, to draw the eye all around.
That's what I'm thinking.
Laugh all the way to that, yeah, that broken basket piece.
And the white is almost balanced from left to right, because you see, as you just pointed out, the white on the little berry baskets. But when you go to the right, the two top baskets there have light or white shining through them, where all the others don't.
So you're noticing the white, and that there is a, it creates a consistency.
Yeah, but there's a very interesting asymmetrical effect that the artist has created. There are three different focal points in, I wouldn't call them focal points, but there are three very different areas of this particular work. There's the basket of tomatoes or peaches or whatever. There's the basket of either cherry tomatoes, I think they're cherry tomatoes or strawberries or whatever. And then there's this very neutral, almost negative space in the lower left-hand corner.
Right, so you're noticing three distinct visual perspectives.
Yes.
And
well, then and then the horizon, and then the sunrise in the sky. Almost four.
So
Billy thinks that that's sunrise. Which, yeah, it looks that way.
So it gives us hope. A new day is dawning.
Michelle, in the comments, Patty had said that this artwork and the previous one have evoked for her a sense of abundance.
Ah, nice. Well, the baskets are mostly full, and the colors are particularly bright. This artist, his name was Richard Kowalski, and his intention was to show that watercolor could be as bright and vibrant as oil. And he did a lot of work and study in this group in this style, rather. So, I just wanted to let you know that.
What is the size of this piece, Michelle?
Christy, let's go to the info slide. 22 by 30.
Okay.
So a little bit bigger than the last one, right, Michelle?
Yeah. Slightly, yeah. Not that much, though. And, okay.
A lot of people, Michelle, have noticed the darker basket. Is it okay if I go back to the big image? Barbara P. Had noticed that the dark basket, to her, it felt like the oldest basket, and that it was the most empty. And Mary had commented that the dark basket is a nice, rich mahogany. Right. I'm wondering if Barbara P. thinks that that's some sort of metaphor.
Well, I'm talking about psychology, I'm wondering if it is a metaphor for, you know, the older basket has less fruit in it, maybe.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that there is, you know, just actually in that whole line, they are darker, at least on the inside of the one in the front, and then the two in the back are darker, and which does generally show older baskets. But, you know, artists, they're inspired. They have an idea and then they express it and go to town. And I hope you enjoyed this. Any last comments? We're going to go on to our last artwork for the day.
I'm just wondering if he didn't see, this wasn't maybe a photograph, or this was something he actually saw, nothing in his mind's eye, but he may have seen something like this, photographed it, and then went back to his studio and painted it in watercolor. I don't know.
Possible. Sure, why not? Mm-hmm. A lot of artists work that way.
Especially with the cropping, the way he's cropped it on one side, well, on the right side.
Right. Yeah.
And we're standing and looking down at the table. The perspective is good as well. It's not as, the view is good.
Right. Yeah, good perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Almost as if you're at the farmer's market.
Right, yeah.
Right. Okay, Christy, if you will, the next and last slide for today. Hmm. Okay, once again, take a look. Okay, what is the first thing that you notice about this artwork?
I noticed that it's serving, but there's no food on the table, and that the utensils, the serving pieces in the far front on the bottom, the two are at an angle, and they're the only two. The rest all seem to be lined up. And the table is worn as you go from the bottom to the top, especially on the right side there, that looks like peeling paint or distressed. So there's no food and the table looks worn. So that's what I see.
Okay. So you're noticing that the table is worn. The two utensils down toward the bottom are the only ones that are facing up, and that there's no food.
I noticed the shapes, the contrast of the colors and the shapes. Before I even see it as a table or anything else, I just look at this as the very geometric and organic contrast.
Right. So you're noticing the shapes, the geometric, the contrast, the colors. Mm-hmm.
And the repetition, it almost looks like a musical staff.
It makes me think of Judy Chicago's dinner party. Perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had to make it very large on my screen in order to actually.
Yeah. Unfortunately, when, you know, this, in fact, actually, Christy and I created another slide. Christy, can you go to the next slide so they can see it?
Yeah.
Okay, so the way that the first slide is how it's supposed to be oriented. This is how it's to be presented. But we did create the other slide so that you would have a closer perspective of this artwork.
Now looking at it, you can see that it almost looks like the pieces are nailed down.
Yeah, they're screwed down.
And the, screwed down to the table.
And the screws are a good inch up still. The artist did not screw it all the way in, left a good inch showing. So.
And the bowl on the bottom, one, two, three, the fourth one in from the left, almost looks as if something could be carved or engraved in there. I don't know if it's initials or numbers or something to that effect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see what you're saying.
In the original position, I visualized eyes, just groupings of eyes looking at me through glasses or whatever the case may be.
Oh,
and
cool.
the little interior cups almost represent the nose and the utensils on the below what were the facial lip expressions or whatever, but that's what glared out at me when I first looked at it. I said, oh my gosh.
That's a great perspective.
Yeah.
They look like a mid-century modern sunglass shape.
Yes. Yes.
The little cup handles are all facing in the same direction.
Direction, yeah. It's cool.
Plus the color combination, the bottom two are yellow with yellow, the top two is orange with orange, and then you only have two that are orange and yellow, and all the rest have the green and yellow.
It's interesting, very interesting.
It also looks, I like that, you know, the whole eye thing is perfect. I was also thinking of avocados and other fruits with big pits. I mean, it's kind of that avocado shape with a great big pit in it when you can't really see what in the small form.
Right. So you're seeing avocados and shapes with pits. An orange with a pit?
papaya. But no, they don't have a big pit.
I see that.
Michelle, there are some really great comments in the chat box that I'd like to share with you. Susan C. had posited that this is perhaps a community table, and she noted, and I think I have never noticed this, but good eye, Susan, that the cups are actually shared across the place settings. And Elaine had noticed that the color of the table is darker at the top and gets lighter as you travel down.
But it's dark then again at the bottom.
Yeah, here along the edge, right, Kathy?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. And even that first layer of blue is similar to the first layer of blue at the top.
Right. And Susan had noted also, as you sort of travel down the table, that you get fewer and fewer utensils, so that by the time you get to the bottom place settings, I think they don't have any utensils at all, if the utensils are sort of underneath, or I should say to the right of the place settings, if you're looking at it that way. And several people, Michelle, have said eyes, that they keep seeing sort of eyes.
Right.
The use of that white fork at the bottom takes your eye back up, which I thought was again structurally a pretty interesting way to get your moving back up.
Did you notice also that the cutlery the spoons and forks are wooden, and some of them are batter beaters? Some of them are slotted. They aren't necessarily functional.
It kind of makes me feel like it was like found art, that the artist got a big box of stuff and decided, well, what can I do? And what Billy started saying at the very start, just the geometrical balance in it. It's like they used everything that they found in that box and kind of went as far as it would go.
That's a really great comment. So you know this particular artist is a self-taught artist.
Right.
And he is someone who does exactly that. So that was an excellent observation. Thanks.
Yeah, it definitely looks like melamac or melamine dinnerware.
Right.
Could we see it the other way again, the larger one left? Yeah. Right?
I can rotate it, but just please keep in mind that this is the way that it's meant to be seen. So mm-hmm. when you're looking at it this way, you really would never see it this way in the museum. Michelle and I had put it on the slide this way just so that folks could maybe appreciate the details a little bit better because of the particularities of this particular medium that we're looking at, you know, using Zoom. But it, in the museum, it hangs on the wall with the orange at the top and the yellow at the bottom.
What is the base made out of?
The table, it looks like wood.
The base, like, I believe the base is made out of wood.
Yeah, that's what it looks like.
Mm-hmm. And the bowls look wooden too. I think the bowls are made of wood.
Yeah.
They look it as well, yeah.
And utensils.
It looks like not all the spoons have holes in them or are slotted. It looks like sometimes they're pairing. The one across from it, I can see, like, has a hole, and then
right.
the spoon above it doesn't have a hole, and this, as it goes through from left to right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, these,
The third red cup up, you can kind of see that there's some type of printed something or an old sticker on the third cup.
Which one, Gary?
The third red cup from, the bottom. Yeah.
It's pretty hard to see because of the angle. I think in the museum we'd be able to see it a little bit easier.
Yeah, that's why I appreciate being able to look at it closer up, and even if it's horizontally and not as it's installed, just because you really can see what these objects are.
I think she's the Michelle's chosen some three interesting sort of approaches to still life, quite different sense about each of them and the progression, the more abstract one to the circular, and then this is very circular too, but dimensional. A nice correlation between the three of them.
Thank you so much, Gavin. I appreciate that.
Dining as well, with the dining theme and food. And just to pick up on the community look, that was one of the early things that I sensed as well, that here's a table for 16 people. It's probably not a family, so it's a community table, or I might even say institutional, but a caring institution. I'm not sure.
You're noticing the uniformity of it, that it could be actually being in some type of institution and yet very community and friendly oriented.
Well, the plates are also very tightly spaced.
Yes.
Not a lot of elbow room there.
And Kathy, I think it looked to me like it was a banquet table. So something that was set for a celebratory, lush kind of lunch. And yet the food bowls are empty. And it reminds me of a charity called Empty Bowls. Are people familiar with that?
Yes.
Yes.
And I'm thinking it's the kind of the, although this might be a table laid out for a community event or a banquet, there are a lot of empty bowls and a lot of people who have empty bowls. So, if you really wanted to read a food social justice kind of take on it, I just thought it was interesting that the bowls were empty.
I also think that the chaser underneath that bowl, it's interesting how she did the colors off it. You know, she could have arranged those haphazardly, but instead we've got, that orange at the top and the yellow at the bottom where there's just a single yellow. And then at the top, you've got the single red on the right, single orange on the right. You know, like, why didn't she do all the orange and green on one side and all the yellow on the other side?
So Gary, you bring up an interesting question for me to pose to you. What is it that has you think that the artist is female?
Yeah.
I'm not, I'm not sure. It's just kind of, it feels soft to me. So that's why I kind of think it was a female. Okay. I do all the cooking in our house, so I wouldn't think it's just because it's kitchen stuff. I don't let anybody else in the kitchen, but I just find those, like the bowls are all soft and everything's kind of round and has a, like not, other than the, and even the table corners are rounded off as well. It's like, it's very, very kid-proof almost. And okay. There's no sharp knives. So I think just the softness of it, other than those screws that protrude out, that's the only kind of hard part on the piece.
Okay. Well, yeah, the artist is male, but he's also one of eight. He is the eighth of 10 children in a family that was very economically depressed.
Wow.
And that's what I find interesting about the spoons with the holes in them.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't really, I understand that it was all dishes. I mean, it was all, cutlery and dishes that were used to create this piece. And yet the more I stare at it, the more I think of an Elbers found object color study. That it's the meaning is not in the objects, although clearly it is, but I'm just play with me here. It's in the color and the arrangement. The meaning is in the colors and the arrangement and the ability to take these found objects to another place than their intended use.
Interesting.
You know,
and what might that be? What might that the intention have been, other than the fact that it was found object? What do you think he was looking to say in this?
Well, one of the things I put in the chat room is that the appearance. So it's distressed blue board. And I believe it is all the same blue, and yet it looks differently at the top underneath the orange than it does around the bottom where it's the pale yellow and the pale green. So that, again, that color study that Elbers likes to do about putting different colors over other colors and seeing how the underlying color changes.
There's an interesting comment in the chat that says, is there a statement being made with the elements being fixed, inaccessibility?
I agree with that. I mean, how can you share a cup if the cup is nailed down? Or is it nailed down because they felt someone might take it or use it? And so to me, as you, the thing, the picture is very barren, the wood is distressed, the things are nailed down so you can't steal them. It's just, almost like pretty colors, but not a happy feeling.
Well, and once again, none of those utensils are really functional for something you would eat out of a bowl.
Yep.
Right, so you're noticing that the utensils are not actually eating utensils that you could actually
not really. No, they're the forks, or there's only one wooden spoon that is, most of them are the flat spoons, so it would be very hard to actually eat something.
Mm-hmm. Mixing, stirring,
yeah.
Well, there's been some very interesting comments about this. Artwork. I call it a sculpture, actually, because of the found object.
A relief.
Go ahead. Okay. We're getting toward the end of our hour together. I wanted to show the info slide on this artwork. So, just to get a perspective, this is 95 by 26 by 6. So there's really quite a presence when it's hanging in the museum, which is one of the reasons why I selected this, because I had seen it And it's really quite extraordinary in person as well. And I want to comment about this particular artist, and something that you might consider doing is going online and taking a look at Joe Minter. This particular artwork is, to me, so unlike all the other things that he's done. As Billy had mentioned, he grew up very poor in a very racist society. They didn't have a lot of means, and he has created something from found objects that looks nothing like this artwork. So you might find that interesting. I'm going to wrap up the afternoon and ask for any last comments about any of the artworks or anything like that. And I have one thing to leave you off with, and that is, art is inspiration and expression in form. Artists create their own language. You don't have to know what the artist meant. What there is to do is engage with the art. And that's it today. I had a great time. I hope you did too. Thank you for joining us today. And I look forward to inviting you into the museum at some point in the near future. And now,
thank you so much, Michelle.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And Michelle, I love your virtual background today. I feel like you're giving us a tour in the museum.
Yeah, it's the reason why I selected it.
Yeah, Donald Sultan Poppy's, Lemons behind me. Thank you so much, Michelle. We really appreciate your guidance today and for choosing these three very different still lives. They really did elicit a lot of conversation, and I've really loved not only seeing the familiar faces this week, but welcoming a few new people. Keep coming back. We have a lot of fun every Friday. Next Friday, if you had tuned in, I believe that it was at the beginning of this month, our touring docent Hank Bovey had selected three artworks and sort of posed the question to them, is it art? And so he really loved the topic and the conversation that we had last month, and so he's doing it again. So next week at Friday at 12, he's chosen three more artworks from our collection, and it's called Is It Art? Part 2. So if you'd like to join us, just send me a quick email and I'll get you on the list. Always a pleasure to spend time with you. Thank you again, Michelle. Thanks to all of you for coming, and we'll look forward to seeing you again soon. The video from today, in case you'd like to share with anyone, will be posted to the website within the next 24 hours, probably by the end of the day. And of course, as always, keep an eye out on your email for a short evaluation. Thanks, and have a great weekend.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.